Hi everybody, I am Dr. Prabhu, Professor and Head, Department of Public Health Industry. Today we are going to see about sampling technique. Sampling technique means first we are supposed to know what is sample, how we are going to select the sample, how we are going to estimate the size of the sample, everything we are going to deal in this session. So coming to sample, when you do a research, actually you cannot go to each and every person and collect the data. So what you do, you just pick some subjects or some people in that whole population, in that entire population, and try to bring out the findings from them which will represent the whole population. That is called as sample.
Understand the whole process of sampling technique, you need to understand certain terminologies, which is very important for you to understand what is sampling technique and all the types. So first is the parent population, second is what is a sampling, third is what is a sampling frame. So parent population is nothing but a part of your sample which is otherwise known as universal, reference or parent population. So, I'll give you an example. Your parent population will definitely include all the individuals, and this will help you to draw your final sample individuals. So, for example, I'll give you in terms of a study where you assess the knowledge, attitude and practice of bioethics among undergraduate and postgraduate students of some specific district. For example, in Chennai city, what you do? You get the list of all the dental colleges in Chennai city and you include all the undergraduate and postgraduate students. That becomes your parent population. From that, you do a sampling. Sampling is nothing but a process or technique of selecting a sample of appropriate characteristics and adequate size. What does this mean is, this will filter you among the dental and postgraduate, undergraduate, postgraduate students in Chennai city from various colleges. From them, according to inclusion exclusion criteria and according to your study design, some will be selected depending upon what sampling technique you use. Now next comes the sampling frame. Sampling frame is the actual list of individuals that the sample will be drawn from. This is ideally, it will include all the target population. Yeah, obviously, this will include all your target population, and depending upon the sampling technique you use, the sampling frame might differ. So this is a continuous process starting from parent population. So after you draw your parent population, from that you select a sampling. Then from that you select a sampling frame. So this is a continuous process. Next is your sampling size. So sampling size is also very important because this will be a representative of your whole population. So for example, when you have your target population, number of target population is 50,000, means at least you have to draw a sample size adequately according to your number of target population you get. So before moving on into any study, you have to calculate sample size. There are certain softwares which calculate sample size, and there are certain formulas also depending upon mean, confidence interval and so on. But now we use softwares which is very high end and which is very easy to obtain the sample size, like G-Power, N-Master, etc.
First of all, you are supposed to know what is the difference between a population and a sample. Population is nothing but, it's also called as universe. That is nothing but the entire population is called as population. The entire population means the entire subjects whom you are going to do the study or research. So that population will have different subsets of characteristics into that. For an example, in that whole population, there will be different geographical area, people spread out in different geographical area, gender differences, means there will be males, females, and there would be different age group, from child, adolescent to adults and old age people. So that kind of variation in age also would be there in the general population. So similarly, there are a lot of subsets of variations involved in that whole population. So in the sampling technique, you are supposed to take, if you are supposed to take for the whole population, the total subjects are called as population. From that, due to constraint in time, energy, or else to go and meet out the whole population, the scope will not be that much. You cannot go to each and every household and each and every person and collect the data. For an example, in the whole India, there are more than 120 crore people. So to study something about dental caries or to study about some pandemic, you cannot go to the whole population, you cannot knock the whole door of every household and collect the data. So that is where the sample comes. Sample is nothing but a representative population, means a few of the subjects from the entire population, you are going to pick some subjects. That is called a sample. So how the sample should be? Sample should really represent, it should be a representation of the whole population. The whole population, if you consider its whole India, in that there will be lot of subsects, like there will be different states for geography, from Tamil Nadu to Kashmir. Similarly, males and females will have different characteristics. So you are going to pick some sample from them also. Similarly, there will be age group differences from childhood to adult to old age. So to represent that age, you are going to pick some sample from them. So this is the difference between the whole population and sample. Now we are going to see about the ideal characteristics for a sample. First is efficiency, second is representativeness, third is measurability, fourth is size, fifth is coverage, sixth is goal orientation, seventh is feasibility, and eighth is economic and cost efficiency.
Ideal requirements of a sample. Ideal requirements may include efficiency. First, what is efficiency? It is nothing but the ability of the sample to yield the desired information. What you understand from these lines is you should obtain whatever information you need for your study protocol. For example, you are doing a oral health status in a specific community, then you have to obtain each and every information to obtain your oral health status or to conclude the percentage or prevalence of oral health status in the community. Next, representativeness. Representativeness is nothing but when you choose a sample from the parent population should be a perfect representative of the of your study design. For example, the same example, when you test a prevalence of oral health status among a specific community, then that specific community should be your parent population. It should not be any other community members can't be under this parent population. Third is measurability. Measurability is nothing but the design of the sample should be such that valid estimates of its variability can be made. That is, the investigator should be able to estimate the extent to which findings from the sample are likely to differ from the parent population. Yeah, the measurability is very important in the study. Fourth is size. Yeah, the size should always be large enough to minimize sample variability and allow us to estimate the population characteristic, and it should be made with measurable precision. So always your sample size should be large enough to conclude a definitive variable. Coverage. Adequate coverage is very essential if the sample has been remained as representativeness. High rates of refusal or non-response or loss to follow-up and other missing data can make a sample unrepresentative of the parent population. So when you choose a sample from parent population, choose as much as and cover as much as possible. Then due to unresponsiveness or due to loss of follow-up or due to many other reasons, it may lose its connectivity, so that you will end up with small sample size and you might not end up by covering the whole of your parent population. Next, moving on to goal orientation. Sample selection should be oriented towards the study objective and research design. So always your goal should be to your what is your objective of the study and what is your research design. That main should be your goal orientation. Seventh, feasibility. This design should be simple enough to be carried out in practice. So whenever you perform a study, so it should be very good enough so that that will be applicable to your practice. Economy and cost efficiency. The sample design should be such that it should yield the desired information with appropriate saving in time and cost and with least sampling error. So, for example, you find out a treatment intervention which is very cheaper. For example, you find out a filling for a posterior which is very strong and it's very efficient and it might be very good restorative capacity for almost 5 years with a very minimal cost. Then the restorative material in the market means then yours is very much applicable and it's an ideal requirement of a sample. So you should make in mind of all these 8 terms. What are they? Efficiency, representativeness, measurability, size, coverage, goal orientation, feasibility, economy and cost efficiency.